Lord, we love you so much. We welcome you. Lord, we are thankful your word says we're two or three gathered together in your name, you're there. So Lord, we ask you to open our hearts to hear your word and to better, so that we can better understand you in 2024 and be a light on a hill, not hidden. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. So tonight, I'm gonna have a quick lesson. And then we're going to have a quick discussion. And so congratulations on coming tonight, because you're going to get to help direct the direction of Wednesday night classes. As soon as we get done with this class, we're going to have an open forum and a vote. So tonight, So tonight, we're going to continue to talk about the historical landscape of the early New Testament church. So, for the last six meetings, we have looked at things such as the miraculous place in Bethlehem. We talked about the possibility of Jesus being born in a cave, not a barn, as we often think. We began to open this dialogue when we look at at verifiable history, at how we find that a lot of our preconceived notions about the Bible are not necessarily what the Bible nor history tells us. We looked at things like how Helena, who was Constantine's mother, was really the first church historian and sought to preserve the historical landmarks of Jesus' ministry in the early 4th century. We've also leaned heavily on the first few chapters of Luke and Matthew, and we're going to continue to do that tonight, to understand the arrival of Jesus into this world. In the Gospels, we find that Mary is the primary source of most of the events that have unfolded regarding Jesus' entry into the world. And we've also found out in this class that each of the four Gospels gives us a unique perspective on almost every event that is recorded in them. For instance, Luke is the only one that tells us about the trip to Bethlehem. We also discussed some of the reasons why Adonai would choose Mary and Joseph. Both were descendants of David. A careful Bible history look at the Bible reveals that both Mary and Joseph were descendants of David. We found out that Mary's father was a scroll scholar through looking at some other writings in history around that time. And she was likely raised in the meeting place, or in the synagogue, or whatever you want to call it. She was a church kid. And she was dedicated to God from infancy. I don't know if we talked about this, but many of the young girls in this time would have in some ways been prepared to be the vein of the Messiah. So she was in that vein, but she also found favor with God. And so we've looked at some of that. Also, we looked at some of the expectations. And so I'm going to get into some new stuff. And tonight, one of the new things I want to talk about is Old Testament prophecy. I was doing some reading in a different book a couple weeks back, and I found something that I thought was interesting that I want to share with you tonight. In many parts of the Old Testament, we begin to see these prophecies of the coming Messiah, right? But by the time that we bust on the scene at, 50 BC or 5 AD, whatever you want to, so by the time we bust on the scene here, the common perception among the Jewish people is not one but two different Messiahs. And I'll talk about that a little bit tonight. We see in Isaiah these prophetic images of the suffering one. And Joseph, they were looking at Joseph, not Jesus' dad Joseph, but Joseph, that was lived in a pit and had a coat of many colors, that Joseph. They were looking at him as kind of the type and shadow of the one that would come to serve and suffer. The Hebrews also had imagery of the prophetic Messiah being the king who would come in the lineage of David. And so what happened, because you have this prophetic imagery of a suffering one and this prophetic imagery of a king, they concluded that this must be two different messiahs. So that kind of helps set the backdrop of why there's some confusion on Yeshua as Messiah, because which one is he? And so is he the one that would suffer, or is he the one that would be the king? And so the Hebrews, I'm going to read my notes. The Hebrews found these two images of Messiah confusing. Messiah king versus Messiah servant. So much so that the Jewish scholars, by the end of the BC era, so, you know, you go backwards in the year. So by about the year zero or somewhere in that reign, they had concluded that there must be two Messiahs. Messiah ben David and Messiah ben Joseph is what they were called. So the Messiah of David was viewed as the highly kingly Messiah who would come in on a horse and rid them of whatever empire was imposing upon them at that time. And so by the time this was popular, you had the Seleucid Empire that was kind of this faction of the Greeks falling apart, and then the Romans came in as the Roman Republic, and then by the time the Roman Empire got going, that it was constantly somebody that was ruling and oppressing them. And so they had to have, in their mind, Messiah had to be the one getting rid of the Roman rule. And we get into this trap because we think, oh, let's pray for the president. They got to come in and do X, Y, and Z or whatever. So they're not alone in this. But they couldn't quite imagine how the king and the servant would be the same person. Now, we have the benefit of 2,000 years of church history and a fully completed canon of scriptures where we can see everything and how it is interwoven, and we can see how Yeshua is both the suffering one and the king, but they couldn't quite see that. So back on this topic of trying to, you know, go through some of the things we've covered to kind of make sure we all are on the same page before we get into tonight's lesson. We talked about Joseph being a highly skilled technician, and we looked at his lineage of and how he and Mary both fit the prophetic picture. And we looked at Nazareth and what that would mean in regards to Isaiah 11:1, which Dan doesn't have that scripture. I'm just going to read it to you. Nazareth literally means netzer in the Hebrew, and it means a shoot or a branch. And Isaiah 11:1 says a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Additionally, we've discussed how Joseph was probably not a mere carpenter, but I want to help give some illustration because we talk about, well, Joseph was a carpenter because they kind of talk down to Jesus's trade as a carpenter, but then we find that he was probably a highly skilled tecton. I hope after tonight's lesson, when you see what happens from the time Jesus is a toddler till about the time Jesus is 6 or 7 years old, will kind of help bring those two ideas of, is he just a carpenter or is he a highly skilled worker? I hope by the end of the lesson tonight, you got some more cohesion on that. Tecton is someone who creates something out of nothing. And I made the point several weeks ago when we talked about that I thought it was really cool that Adonai would choose a creator to rear Yeshua in the flesh. So we also discussed the immense character we find in Joseph. And the reason I'm going over these again, some of you may have forgot, you may not have been here, but they're pivotal to tonight's lesson. We discussed how Joseph was a merciful man because he decided he would not shame Mary publicly, but he would put her away privately prior to the angelic visit. But we also see when the angel shows up that Joseph quickly trusts God and obeys. We also have looked at the swaddling clothes and why those were important to the shepherds, and how that those were a sign for the Bethlehem shepherds. And then we spent a significant time, and yet again, this is important, we've spent a significant amount of time discussing the reign of Herod the Great and how he rose to power. We looked at how historically Herod was evil and how this aligns with the biblical narrative. And so I'm going to just refresh our minds. I'm going to read Matthew 2, 13 through 18, and I'm going to use the New International Version tonight. Verse 13, when they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, he said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child and kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod, and so fulfilled what the Lord said through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Verse 16, when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time that he had learned from the Magi's visit. Then that fulfilled what was said through the prophet Jeremiah, "A voice is heard weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more." So this is what this is kind of the crux of our lesson tonight. We're going to talk about the flight into Egypt. And so history tells us, it is well documented, that Herod was a paranoid tyrant, and he lived his life driven by constant fear that somebody would steal his throne from him. Now, if you're a New Testament scholar, I want to briefly mention this. If you are a New Testament scholar and you're thinking, well, man, Herod lived a long life, there are like four or five Herods referred to in the Bible, and they're not all the same dude. The next Herod we're going to learn about is actually this Herod's son, but then there's this offshoot that comes down, and that's different names of Herod because that was part of Herod's dynasty, if you will. But Herod the Great, the one who was reigning over this area at the time of Yeshua's birth, was pretty ugly. He was pretty mean. He was a bad dude. And so when we look at a timeline, we find that Herod actually comes to be on the earth around 72 BCE, and he lives for about 7 decades, and so he dies not long after Jesus' birth, but he's the one that's there. We've talked about this, but I just want to make mention again because it kind of helps set the backdrop. He rose to power by being a well-connected Roman citizen. He was not chosen of God nor the Jewish people. He was chosen because he was about half Jewish, and he married a Hasmonean princess, and so that's kind of give him enough legitimacy, but he was still in the pocket of Rome, so that kind of helped him become king of the Jews. And we briefly discussed how Israel was living in this like post-revival era, when the Seleucid Empire started to collapse and struggle. Israel was going through this like return to correct temple worship. And so one of the last Seleucids, and Myra talks a lot about this in her class on Friday nights, one of those last guys sacrificed a pig in the temple, and that's what kind of brought us that movement of revival. And so you've got this new guy, Herod, and you've got this rise of these four factions of the worship of Adonai of Israel. You've got the Essenes, the Zealots, the Sadducees, and the Pharisees. And then you got this Roman-appointed evil dude who's doing some good things, and we've discussed some of those good things he's done. But he's doing these bad things, but he's evil. He's appointed by Rome. He's killing high priests. He's appointing high priests. So, like, they're not happy with him, but they're not in revival mode, because when you begin to look at history, you will find that revival happens, and then the children of revival act right, and then the grandchildren of revival act half right, and then the great-grandchildren of revival act about 25% right, and we're currently in the great-great-grandchildren where ain't none of them acting right, because this cycle of history, because often history will repeat itself, and so we're kind of in this several generations removed from this revival to reconnect with temple worship and do it in the way that God had ordained in the Word. And so that's kind of the historical backdrop that we find here, that Rome, the Roman Empire, rolls in 63 BCE. Okay, so about 60 years before the arrival of Jesus, we get the Romans. And so, quick mention, the Seleucid Empire was part of the Greeks because of Alexander the Great, 350 years or so BCE. He came in and he spread the Greek government. He spread the Greek Empire. And it's because of those Aristotle, Plato, forgetting one of them. The Greek philosophy and the Greek language and the Greek Empire is what helped the church be able to spread. And so they're at the bottom here, and the Roman Empire has risen. And so that's kind of the backdrop where we're at. Greece is down, Rome is up. And Greek is a common language. And I took this note. Greek was a common language and provided for the spread of the gospel to the Gentiles in all four corners of the Roman Empire within a couple decades. Listen, this one scholarly writer writes this. In the first Christian century, okay, in the first 100 years, there was an astonishing growth rate of 40% per decade. Most growth came from individual conversations, not only from the poor, but also from merchant and upper classes. Most converts were women. Can you believe that? I thought women weren't able to preach the gospel. Most converts were women, and some women were influential leaders. Now, this is academia. This is not, I didn't pull this from John MacArthur's website, surprisingly. Some of you got that joke. The Christian population grew by 40% a decade, from about 1,000 Christians in the year 40 to 7,500 Christians in year 100 to a little over 6 million by the year 300 to 33 million by the year 350. So you have this massive growth of Christianity. Which, why am I talking about that? Why does that matter? Well, to me, it makes it a little bit more real. Because here we are with our 2024 goggles, looking at a book, not understanding what the empire was, who was ruling, what was going on. Like Jesus, we find the ministry of Jesus, we find him going from place to place, and it talks about it in the Bible, and we just brush right over it. Well, I was reading the Gospels about a week ago, reading through the Gospels, and I get to this point where Jesus casts a demon out of a man and they go into some swine. And I thought, now I've read that, y'all, a lot. I thought, why were they mad about demons going to a swine? Jews didn't like swine. Well, you do just a smidge of research, 95% of the population was non-Hebrews. So they were mad because Jesus just got rid of their bacon. So it's like when we understand these things, to me it makes it more real. Now, I don't need it to be more real, but I like to go into this stuff. So anyways, that's kind of the backdrop there. So last week we finished last week talking about the Magi. Now, we've talked 2 or 3 weeks about the Magi. If you don't care about nothing other than the Magi, I think it would be worth going back and watching those and reading some of these things about the Magi. That was incredible. They were kingmakers, they were powerful, they traveled with probably a caravan of 1,000. It wasn't just the 3 of them. And we talked about 7 things that they entered that were significant. They entered Jesus' house. They saw him as a young child. They fell down and worshiped him. And we talked about the Greek word there that when they fell down and worshiped him, it wasn't casual. It was a we're choosing that you are the king. They opened treasures, and I'm telling you this again because it's important to remember because what we're about to study. They opened treasures that were numerous of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And so I'm going to just quickly, no, I'm not. The reference to that is Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through like 13, 12. If you need refreshing, read that on your own time. So I'm going to pick up in Matthew. I'm going to read this, Dan. I'm going to go to the message that I give you, the Message translation 2, but I'm going to jump in at like verse 12. It says in a dream, God, you're awesome, Dan. In a dream, they, who were they? That was the Magi, were warned not to report back to Herod, so they worked out another route. They left the territory without being seen and returned to their own country. After the scholars, the Magi, were gone, God's angel showed up again to Joseph in a dream. Okay, again, well, the first time was when the angel of the Lord said, hey, this is going to be the Christ. Don't put away Mary. You need to do some stuff. Again, the angel shows up and commanded, get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt. Stay until further notice. Herod is on the hunt for this child and wants to kill him. Joseph obeyed. He got up, took the child and his mother under cover of darkness. And I'm going to reread all of this in the New King James so you can kind of see the two. And we're going to talk about some Greek words. But under the cover of darkness, this is how the message puts it. Under the cover of darkness, they went out of town and were well out of there by daylight. They lived in Egypt until Herod's death. This Egyptian exile fulfilled what Hosea had preached. I called my son out of Egypt. Herod, when he realized that the scholars had bested him, had tricked him, he flew into a rage. He commanded the murder of every little boy under 2 years old that lived in Bethlehem and the surrounding hills, and he was able to determine that age from the information he had gotten from the scholars. So, the emphasis, I know we've spent like 20 minutes, the emphasis of tonight's lesson, Herod's persistent fears and suspicions of losing his throne to a rival king are what fueled the fire of his recurring murderous acts, including the massacre of the babies in Bethlehem, which we have not talked about in this class. God protected and provided for his son Jesus as well as for Joseph and Mary, making a way of escape into the land of Egypt where they lived for about 3 years. So now I'm going to go verse by verse and go through some of this. Verse 13 in the New King James says this. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream saying, arise, take the young child and his mother and flee to Egypt and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child and try to destroy him. So I've got our Greek words, and yet again, remember, Greek was the universal language. Got our Greek words here that we can start going through. The first Greek word, P-H-E-U-G-O. And I listened to the video, but I can't remember. Sorry. I can't get it to come out. In this passage, flee is important. Flee is the P-H-E-U-G-O word. Flee means to flee or take flight. When you go into the Greek lexicon, it can mean to run away, but it typically would mean to flee and run away as fast as possible in an escape situation. It points to one's feet flying as he runs from a dangerous situation. Hence, the angel in Joseph's dream told him to move his feet as fast as he could to get out of Nazareth and gave direction to go to Egypt. He didn't just say run away. He said go there. Now, I'm going to take a break from my notes and teach a prophetic people for a minute. If the Lord tells you to flee, he's going to give you specific instructions on where to go. If the enemy tells you to flee, it's because he's wanting you to run away from God's judgment. And when I say judgment, I don't mean God's wrath. I mean God's judgment in your life that's going to bring you up a scale, that's going to take you to a new level. You don't just run away to run away. If you need to leave a situation, leave a place, leave something, God will tell you where you're going. You don't just run away. So, that was free. Not part of the notes. Furthermore, in verse 13, we find where the word tells us, Matthew tells us, Herod will seek the young child. So, that doesn't mean I'm going to send my goons one time and we're going to kill a couple kids and I'm going to get over it. No, we have in this class well established the biblical and historical facts that Herod was a madman. He was rent on this. He was not going to give up. So the Greek word here is zetio, which is a futuristic tense, meaning the way Matthew writes this is that Herod indicates here that he's going to continue to pursue and seek and pursue and seek and earnestly search for. It depicts one who's upset about not getting what they want and they don't give up. Have you ever met a narcissistic person that does this? This is Herod. But not only is this Herod, he has, keep in mind, he's not just king of Israel, this small little country. He's king of Israel, this small little country, but he is buddies with Israel, who is part of the Roman Empire, who is it. They are the power of the day. So his rule doesn't go into Egypt, but he has influence in Egypt. He has influence all over, not only the Mesopotamia, but the entire Mediterranean. Because he's not a Roman official, but he is a Roman-appointed king, so he has this power. So he is on the seeking, investigating, never giving up. He's going to pursue what he wants. It actually can denote and has been used to denote a scheming individual who manipulates people, events, circumstances to get whatever the narcissist wants. And then the Greek word here for destroy is apollyon, which means to destroy, ruin, devastate, total destruction. The angel of the Lord was keenly aware of Herod's intentions, which is why he issued orders for Joseph and his family to evacuate Nazareth. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt. Now that's verse 14. And so what I want you to gather here, Herod is a step behind. Herod is sending his goons to Bethlehem to murder children, but Jesus and Mary and Joseph are in Nazareth. But even though Herod is a step behind, there's urgency in the message from the angel, get up and get out of here. There's urgency. Because Herod's reach would continue to find him. It wasn't just a one and done and I'll let it be. Verse 14, we see Joseph not questioning God. He responds with prompt obedience and does exactly what God is looking for from us. Yes, sir, I'm doing it. He arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt, verse 15, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Verse 16, then Herod, when he saw that he had been deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry and sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and its districts from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had been determined. The Greek word here for deceived actually means he felt mocked. What you don't want to do is mock a narcissistic king. The Greek word is empadzio, which means to be outwitted, to be made fun of, to be ridiculed, or to be mocked. That was the wrong. He was threatened enough by the fact that the Magi showed up and said, there's another king here. But they said, I see you're $15 and I raise you $10 million. And he felt embarrassed and mocked, and he felt like they had slighted him. And so he was in a rage at this point. One thing we know about this personality type, this will cause them to fly into an absolute fit. Especially after he had treated the Magi like royalty, he was deeply offended that they had outwitted him and gone home another way. He was exceedingly angry. Actually, in the King James original, it says he was wroth with anger. The Greek word thumo, which describes someone who is enraged and livid. It pictures somebody in an uncontrollable anger, what we would call a real down home hissy fit. So he sent forth and he slew and put to death all the male children in Bethlehem. In spite of all that Herod was determined to do, he didn't know exactly which child. He didn't know exactly which toddler. Nor which parents. He didn't know they had left Bethlehem and they were back in Nazareth. Now, this shows us something I feel like that might be unpopular. But this shows us that Satan is not all-knowing. He's not as smart or as powerful as some might think. He could have said, "Hey, Herod, he's in Nazareth, oh boy." The demons that run and controlled Herod, had Satan been all-knowing, clearly Herod couldn't identify which child it was that had been prophesied king of the Jews. That's why he sent his troops to Bethlehem, not Nazareth. It was a last-ditch effort to retain power by killing them. If I kill them all, surely I'll get the one that the Magi declared to be the new king. So I found it strange that only Matthew writes about the genocide. And I also find it strange that it's not recorded in Josephus's writings. So I did some digging. We know, we have talked about the historical side of Herod's fits. We have talked about the gospel, which we all believe in the word. So we don't need history to confirm this. But I still, yet my little wondering mind went to wondering. We know Herod was apt to kill 70, 80 people at a time. He even killed his favorite wife. He didn't care. He did. He killed his favorite wife. She was his favorite, but his favorite was remaining in power. That was his favorite. Anything else did not matter. So anybody that was a slight threat to him, he murdered. They could look at him the wrong way. You gotta see the demonic and the personality problems that this man had. So, in the grand scheme of things, I began to wonder how many toddlers were actually killed. Now, there's varying estimates. There are some estimates that circulate that it's 14,000, 16,000, 64,000. However, when I read the word, it tells me it was Bethlehem and the surrounding region. When I go and look at historical documents, and considering its absence from the other gospels and other writings and Jewish historical documents, perhaps there's another explanation. Now, this is not gospel. This is not gospel. Don't take this as gospel, but this is kind of where I come at with this. One or two or three academic theologians and scholars began to talk about this, and so I went out and looked. Remember, we talked about Bethlehem. It wasn't a big city. It was 480 people. So, therefore, killing thousands would have been difficult. So modern scholars that take the literal Bethlehem population and its reign, and they state that the number of massacred children could have really been less than 20. And so then there's some other historians that get involved, and they can actually math this thing and stat this thing down to 10 or 15. To be clear, the killing of any child is horrific. The enemy has been after children since the beginning. We can see this with Molech, and we can see this with abortion now. We can see that the enemy wants to kill and destroy children. We see that. But the point I'm making in this conversation is, if this was less than 20, I could see how Josephus would not have put it in his writings. I could see how the other authors of the other text of the Gospels would have left it out, because it would have totally been in tow for what Herod did. It would have been kind of like leaving out a mean tweet from Donald Trump, or a slurred sentence from Joe Biden. It was just a normal thing. That wasn't in the notes, but I thought that was hilarious, by the way. All right, so I'm almost at the end of this little conversation here. So what we find, miraculously, through all this mayhem, Jesus and his parents were protected. They were out of the reach of Herod, and they ended up heading to Egypt. So let me just talk a little bit about their Egypt journey here. Joseph's close relationship with God and his prompt obedience led to the saving of his entire family. It's the same way with us, ladies and gentlemen. When we stay close to the Lord, we must listen and obey. What's that good old gospel song we sing? Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy. Jeez. We could just stop right there. We live in that place, we can stay in his divine protection. So, in Egypt, God supplied the holy family's every need. I'm going to try to stick to my notes here because my brain's ahead of my notes. There was a world of difference between Hebrew Nazareth and Egypt. Nevertheless, it was beyond Herod's specific domain. Did you know Herod still sent spies to pursue the holy family? But it was easier for them to hide and blend in. Joseph also had no legal right or legal authority to work while he was in Egypt. See, we get this mindset that they lived in Egypt for 3 years and they moved into a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house. And Joseph transferred his business from one place to another. And that's not historically what we find to be the case. You'll find that in a minute. I'll go over that in a minute. They were on the move the entire time they were in Egypt. Egypt was expensive, but nonetheless, this didn't catch God by surprise. He knew all these details in advance. Perhaps that's why he sent the Magi to supernaturally open up their treasures and gifts just before. I mean, the night before you're about to have to go on a 3-year journey, a run for your life, and millions of dollars shows up. He's an on-time God, ladies and gentlemen. God supplied the financial resources to meet his son's needs while on the move, almost as if he knew what would later be written to the Philippians in 4:19, "And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." I'm going to give us a side note on that scripture, because as I was reading this, it just hit all over me. Supply here means to make full, complete, or filled up beyond the point of satisfaction. And may God supply all your needs according to not my riches, not the economy of the United States, not the economy of Israel, but according to his riches in glory. Dan, let's go ahead and throw that map up. Scholars estimate that the map, There should just be one map that that emailed you. Scholars estimate that Joseph, Mary, and Jesus stayed in the land of Egypt about 3 years. They would have traveled around 1,200 miles by foot or animal or ship. There were two routes they could have taken to get from Nazareth to Egypt. One was called the Via Maris, the Way of the Sea. That was the primary route. The alternate route, which was most scholars believe they probably used, traveled them through the desert. It was much more difficult to traverse, but it was more secretive and was probably safer for them to avoid detection. And that's why most scholars believe they went that way. Now, the oldest records from the Egyptian Coptic Church confirms this. Now, what I want you to understand, in our 2024 brains, we think Egypt, we think what religion? Muslim. There was no such thing as Muslims at this point. One of the five essential churches that if y'all want to go there, we can study at some point in time. One of the five essential churches, the church at Alexandria, was in Alexandria, Egypt. Everybody ever heard of the Library of Alexandria? Some of the greatest scholars and thinkers of that time, some of the early church fathers, especially leading up into the Nicene era, come from Alexandria, which was in northern Egypt. So, the Coptic Church, which is part of the Oriental tradition, and many people believe the Coptic Church, or the church at Alexandria, the church at Alexandria was founded as early as 49 AD, and that's accredited to Mark, but we don't know that for sure. But if that was the case, then that's really cool. And it becomes one of the five holy sees in the patristic period. Okay, what are the patristic period? That's the period of the early church fathers, the five holy sees, Jerusalem, Antioch, Alexandria, Rome, and Constantinople. Those were where that was the church you had to fall under in the first 2 or 3 centuries. So, once Herod realized, I'm on my last page. Once Herod realized that Christ's child had escaped, he dispatched spies into the land of Egypt. which explains why there are at least 30 locations on this map where the Holy Family spent time while in Egypt. And I have a full list if anybody wants to see this. This is why it's called Flight Through Egypt, not, like I said earlier, they bought a brick house, 3 bedrooms, 2.5 baths, air fryer on the counter, and they enrolled Yeshua in the basketball program. That's not what happened. They were on the run until Herod died. Without question, the angel had said about this. Herod is seeking diligently to find Christ, and it becomes a reality in verse 13. The whole time the whole family was in Egypt, Herod pulled out all the stops, sending spies to locate Jesus. Verse 15 tells us they were there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord of the prophet, saying, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Now, Matthew 2, 19 through 23 in the NLT, and then we're gonna conclude tonight's lesson. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. So, Joseph's in Egypt, Herod dies, yet again another angel shows up to Joseph. Why? Because he constantly said yes when an angel showed up. You've got to say yes to get another encounter, to go another level. "Get up," the angel said, "take the child and his mother back to the land of Israel, because those who were trying to kill the child are dead." See how it says those who are trying to kill the child? Not just Herod has him on his wish list to murder. All of those that's been pursuing and trying to kill the child are dead. Verse 21, "So Joseph got up, returned to the land of Israel with Jesus and his mother. But when he learned the new ruler of Judea was Herod's son Archelaus, he was afraid to go there. Then after being warned in what? Another dream, he left for the region of Galilee, so that the family went and lived in a town called Nazareth that fulfilled the prophets, which said he would be called a Nazarene." So you can begin to see in just a few verses that we covered tonight that every prophetic word spoken in Scripture about Jesus was fulfilled. Even through the difficult years of being hunted and living on the run in Egypt, God faithfully provided everything Jesus and his parents needed. He'll do the same for you and the same for me. Now cue the song, "He'll Do It Again." All right, if we would, let's go offline. Bye, everybody online, and we're going to have a conversation. So,